And as the government continues to record an increasing number of cases, it is also enforcing stricter ECQ regulations. How much longer can Filipinos hold under this lockdown? We discuss in this episode of The Chiefs. Welcome to the special edition of The Chiefs, and with us tonight are, of course, Robbie Alampay of One News, Ami Pamintuan of the Philippine Star, and of course, we are with News 5 Chief Luchi Cruz Valdes. Luchi, welcome back to the show.
Hi.
I made an online appearance.
well, what are you guys... Yeah. Oh, kumusta yung ano? Quarantine. Kamusta? Sa Quezon City. Quarantine. Sa bahay Toro, di ba?
Ay, bahay Toro. Total lockdown daw.
Yeah.
Pero wala nang mag-insulate yung barangay captain eh. So, and residents are really confused. Kung saan ba talaga nagagaling yung directive for a total lockdown? Kasi alam natin lahat, di ba, it should come from the mayor.
Mm-hmm. And from what I understand, sa Facebook ata in-announce, ganun ba?
Yeah, sa Facebook, tapos unsigned. So wala siyang pirma. So medyo malabo. Pero ganun pa nga, everybody is complying for fear, of course.
Yeah, but Luchi, when you say everybody's complying, ano yung itsura ba ng quarantine ngayon dyan sa barangay? I mean, what does that mean? Pagka iba pa sa nadaranas namin, what are you complying with? What are the new regulations?
You're talking about us. I don't know because I haven't really been out. So I don't really know what's obtaining in other places. All I know is we have, I think, one of the highest numbers of infections in our territory. So, yun.
Parang sa Sampaloc, Manila, eh, they're going to lock down the entire district anytime soon. Wala pang pecha, pero for 2 days, for 48 hours, sila lockdown yung Sampaloc.
That's what we want to know. If that's even legit, is it legit? Mm.
Pero yung sa Sampaloc kasi, that was by Mayor Isko Moreno as the head of the GU.
Yeah. Pero sa amin, barangay captain eh. So you wonder now whether it's legit. I mean, is he authorized? I think one of the...
Anyway, Luchi, Bok, ang mahirap nito, tayo yung nagdi-debate. Meron tayong, but, you know, conveniently, meron tayong guest na maybe he can help us out. He knows and he should know how things work at the level of the local governments, on the various levels of local government. Joining us on stream is Valenzuela City Mayor Rex Gatchalian. Mayor Gatchalian, linawin lang po natin, this is Mayor Gatchalian ng Balita. Hindi po ito presidente ng bayan, ng bansa, ng Venezuela. No. Mayor Gatchalian.
Hi, good evening everybody. Yes, this is Rex Gatchalian of Valenzuela City. Hindi ho ng bansa ng Venezuela. Thank you for having me tonight.
Good evening, Mayor.
Good evening.
Total, Mayor, lininaw natin yan para sa'yo na huwag kang sisisihin kung may posisyon sa Venezuela, wala kang kinalaman, lininaw natin yan para sa'yo. Maybe you can, pwede nyo naman linawin para sa amin, ano ba yung patakaran kung merong enhanced community quarantine na level up pa na dinaranas ng ibang tao, kanino ba dapat nang gagaling yung order? Pwede ba yun sa level lang ng barangay o kailangan na sa level ng mayor o kailangan ba na sa level ng DILG?
From my, remember the very first IATF guideline, nandun nakalagay yun eh. Mm. Now when there is a sustained community transmission, yun na-prove talaga na sa loob ng isang barangay, cluster, kalsada, eh nagkakaroon ng community transmission, the local chief executive, which I'm presuming is the mayor, has the option to declare further lockdown, whether it's a cluster, a street, or a barangay. Now, dapat yan sa pagkakaunawa ko, nanggagaling sa mayor, but of course, ang basis mo dyan, kung merong sustained community transmission. Or ang intindi ko nga, nakalagay pa doon, if there are more than two COVID cases na related sa isa't isa. Ganun ang interpretation ko noon. But in my opinion, dapat yun, syempre, may consultation with your health chief and health practitioners. Mm. Kasi marami naman sa amin, hindi doktor. So how do we know kung may community transmission? And I would also think that the barangay captain cannot do that unilaterally in his area. Here in Valenzuela, that's a big no-no. Everything has to go through the mayor's office.
Kung hindi, yung barangays will have their own kingdoms. Parang ganun mangyayari.
Ang problema kasi doon, no barangay is an island eh. You must be able to work with each other in the sense na pag sinara mo yung isa, hindi naman pwedeng isipin mo kaagad na walang epekto to dun sa katabi. Kasi there are landlocked barangays, di ba? There are barangays na yung roads nila magkakadikit. So you have to make sure that the mayor probably, ako ang intindi ko dyan, the mayor declares that. So importante that the mayor knows this para he can make provisions dun sa maapekto ang mga barangay.
Yes. Mayor, you're talking about the authorization sa inyo to declare. Meron kayong discretion na gawin yan. Saka, paano yung ano, sa Manila magla-lockdown dahil nag-violate daw ng quarantine protocols. So may ila-lockdown na barangay. Yun ba authorized ba kayo? Saka saan nakalagay yung authorization nyo? Meron ba talaga yun sa rules? O meron ba kayong mga guidelines for that?
Di ba kanina, yung ma'am, yung nakwento ko, yung sa sustained, yung further lockdowns, nandun yung natatagpuan sa original na IATF, the very first one na guideline na nakalagay doon, the local chief executive, if I can paraphrase ha, if proven that in an area merong sustained community transmission of one or more positive cases, the local chief executive can declare further lockdowns, whether with the city, the barangay, the street, or a apartment complex, a cluster of apartments. Now, madam, ito, this is how I interpret it naman itong sa Manila. Diba, I would always believe that whatever the president says verbally becomes state policy or becomes the government's policy.
Yes.
Diba, meron din, hindi ko sinabi ng Pangulo natin na i-lockdown ng Sampaloc, pero parang sa pagkakaunawa ko dun, paulit-ulit niya sinasabi na pag sobrang pasaway na, the mayor should do what they have to do because they know their terrain very well. So it's a very liberal interpretation in my opinion na you're being given leeway. Alam mo yung lugar mo, alam mo yung ugali ng tao doon, then you do something about it. Hindi pwedeng aantay mo pa yung national government pumasok.
Pero mayor, eto ang tanong. Ano ba nangyayari pag total lockdown? Ibig sabihin ba noon? Hindi talaga pwedeng lumabas. Tapos di ba this goes against the LG advisory na dapat nga wala ng window hours kasi lalong nagkukumpol-kumpol. So hindi mo malaman kung ano bang susundin.
Well, ako very clear. In my opinion, in my interpretation, I have to draw from my own experience eh. Early part ng ECQ, we had a barangay in particular na doon talaga lahat ng COVID cases. But we have an automated system of contact tracing wherein we log in all the common names, all the names, I mean. And then the system will prompt me kung merong relationship yung mga kaso, thereby there's community transmission.
Okay.
I was so close to declaring further lockdown nung barangay na yon. But I had to consult my local the health officer and he said, Mayor, walang relationship. But when we were planning that already, ang intindi ko doon, provisions must be made for food. Dadali mo yun sa bahay-bahay talaga dapat. Provisions has to be made for medicine. So ang intindi ko doon, if you trigger that mechanism, you must be ready to provide food, medicine, or the necessary medical interventions for the residents who will be affected.
Right. Which doesn't happen. I mean, wala namang nag-house to house para mag-deliver ng food. No?
Ma'am, doon sa inyo, you mean?
So parang nagtataka lang ako.
Kasi naka-lockdown na sila eh.
Yeah.
Eh pero ma'am, di ba, like you said a while ago, I was listening. I don't know, no? But I was listening. You said, hindi man nyo sure kung official na yan because hindi naman signed yung copy.
Wala nga. Eh And we haven't heard from anybody so far. So we don't. So those of us abiding, we stay home. But you know, because when you go to the grocery during the window hours, my gosh, the lines are just kilometric.
Ma'am, in Valenzuela kasi, I have no more intentions of declaring that, hopefully, because nga naglo-localized mass testing na kami. So, right now, we're not locking down communities. We're locking down the person. We're isolating the person. Meaning, because of our localized testing, nadadala ko sila sa central isolation unit. I can tell you point blank, there are no more positive cases in our streets. They're either in our isolation unit, they're either in our frontliner hotel, pag frontliner siya, and they're either in the hospital. So I really don't, sorry, baka pangit pakinggan, I have no experience in locking down further or I've never done that because iba yung approach namin. Ang approach namin is following the national template, test, trace, isolate. But ang interpretasyon ko ng isolate, wag mo i-isolate yung walang kinalaman sa gulo, kundi i-isolate mo yung maaring may positive case para mabigyan mo siya ng medical intervention.
Right.
Yes, but Mayor, I presume ang premise dyan is that you have the facilities to isolate people and bring it down. Because kaya nagdi-default dati ang gobyerno at every level to isolate entire communities because wala pang facilities yung lahat ng LGUs. Even now, I imagine, as we said,
Ruby, we're in our fifth week
of ECQ. Pero hindi lahat ng...
If I can interject, ako, I can give you this because I know it. Parang mga January, the DILG already instructed all of us, all mayors, to come up with their central isolation unit. In fact, to be very fair about it, makulit sila dyan. When you say makulit, every week they were following up. We had to submit progress. So I'm assuming all LGU units must have that.
That's right.
Mayor, linawin ko lang. Order ba yung DILG?
Okay. Doon po punta yung tanong ko, Mayor. Linawin ko lang.
Yes?
Na humihingi kayo ng isolation unit, ano pa yung hinihingi ng DILG? Kasi ang kulang daw natin, no, nung nag-umbisa tayo, yung mass testing, may required din ba kayo na kumuha ng ganon? Na
okay. Ma'am,
kailangan
mag-rapag yung...
kayo ng makara, ganon-ganon. Ano pa yung mga inutos ng DILG? You're talking January, no?
Ma'am, we have to, in my opinion, we have to categorize it. Ako sa sarili kong utak, I always compartmentalize it. DILG was in charge of peace and order. That's why there are checkpoints, rules coming out from DILG. Early on, nung January, they told us na kailangan may central isolation unit kami. In fact, there was a memo pa eh. I think that came out first week ng February about central isolation units. And they were really following up regularly. I think DILG was in charge of the security aspect of it. Kasi remember, isolating is also a security aspect. And then, that's all I remember with DILG. When it comes to mass testing, madam, yun yung sinasabi ko the other day, I think came up in one interview saying na that falls in the realm of DOH and sadly, they never told us to pre-position because they were always saying na meron sila, ready sila. In fact, I was saying na ang sad part nito, nung buong February, DOH had that lull. Remember, wala naman tayo humasyadong transmission.
Yung tatlo lang yung positive.
We were so good at it because wala. Tapos nito, pumutok na yung ECQ. Like kami sa Valenzuela, we wanted to take matters into our own hand kasi pag tumatawag kami sa DOH, puro overwork sila because lahat nasa RITM or nasa lung center. So, naghanap kami ng sariling kit namin and lo and behold, we found out that there were not a lot of FDA kits approved. There was not a lot of FDA kits that were being approved then. They came up with the list, ang DOH, ng FDA-approved mass testing kits 5 days after ECQ or 4 days. So we bought from that list, and then lo and behold, nagulat kami, wala rin palang mga laboratory. So we had to wait for 2 weeks to find private labs that they accredited, at doon kami nag-sign up, the Medical City and Dotoxicare Molecular Laboratory. Parang DILG, in my opinion, was very early in seeing what they wanted. But sadly, in my opinion, DOH kind of told us now na lang sa ECQ. In fact, ngayon lang naman nila sinasabi na this is now an LGU-driven patient-centric approach. When they could have told us early on in February, kasi mga LGU sa Metro Manila, may capacity to buy naman. All you have to do is guide us which one to buy.
So, kumusta na po yung inyong testing? Are you, we have enough kits? Are you happy with the quality of the tests that you actually got?
Well, ma'am, first of all, quality. We only bought kits that the FDA DOH approved. We never ventured out of that, or else the numbers will not be consolidated with the national figures.
Right.
So you can't tell me, nobody can tell me na we're not happy with the quality, because dapat dumaan na sa masusing pagsusuri yon ng DOH, both the kit and the laboratory. And I'm confident because remember, we're working with the medical city and a molecular laboratory. So alam ko, they only have the highest QS or quality standards na nandyan. Am I happy? Yes, I'm now very happy since Black Saturday because we control the pace. Remember early on, I also went, I think you guys, your station interviewed me nga na parang tinanggal nila yung PUM sa testing hierarchy, but we insisted that we wanted the PUM tested, and we found out that the PUMs were actually testing positive, even if they were asymptomatic. So I'm happy that at least in Valenzuela, alam namin, kami may control ng pace, sino itetest, when itetest. And the clincher here is, we get the results 48 hours. Every 48 hours, we get the results. So parang hindi na kami nag-aantay ng eternity. We can do contact tracing fast, we can pull out the positive, and we can put them in the isolation unit. Remember, time is of the essence, kasi parang ang intindi ko, this virus, the way it was explained to me, the infection rate nito is parang 16. Every person can infect four in front, four on the side, four at the back, four on your side. So parang you want to contact trace as fast as you can.
Yes. Mm-hmm. How far are you going to push? How far are you going to push the mass testing? Are you going to look at target a percentage? Are you going to target a percentage of the population, or just the PUMs and PUIs?
No, let me qualify. It's targeted mass testing. We're still following the DOH protocol. Meaning, remember, every kit, on an average, WHO said that's 5,500 for a person, the kit and the processing. That's their average in literature. In Valenzuela's case, Yung kit namin is at around 2,650. That includes the swabbing kit, the test kit, and the extraction kit. Tatlo yan. They're always singing the same song. Dapat tatlo sila. And then the processing contract namin with the Medical City and the other lab, Detoxicare, ang average nila 2,000 to 2,000. So, naglalaro yung sa Valenzuela ng 4,500 to 5,000. Lagay mo na at 5,000. And you have to test multiple times ba pag nag-positive yung tao. So medyo magastos. Yeah. So we have to stick with the protocol na number one, all PUM, all PUI, all frontliner. All returning OFWs who are technically PUIs or PUMs. And then also vulnerable sectors like immunocompromised people, yung mga nagda-dialysis. The way we look at it in Valenzuela, if I summarize all of those, that will be around 6,000 tests, and we've already ordered all of those. We're good to go for 1,000 tests every week, and then our processing capacity with the two labs is 115 tests per day.
Okay, and how long will the supply last?
Madam, we reserved early on. So kami, I'm assuming our supplier hedge, kasi matagal na kami nag-reserve, that's 1,000 a week. And I only need 5 weeks to finish. Right now, all our PUI and PUM have been tested. I can tell you that. Wala na kaming backlog. New cases na to sa frontliners na tong tinetest namin. Two more days to go, all the results will be back. Kasi nga 115 a shot. So that's 48 hours for every 115. So by Wednesday, I would know the complete story of all my old PUIs and PUMs. So yung mga bago na lang iaayusin ko.
Nayar, if I'm hearing you right, mukhang confident naman kayo that you're, if not already caught up, you're catching up with where you wanted to be from the public health perspective weeks ago. You have the facilities, you have the resources, you're happy that you have more leeway to have your initiative to address the isolation, the testing, and so on. What about on the matter, on the socioeconomic matters now?
Yeah. So that's
what is the perspective of your local government with regards to extending the ECQ?
Okay, that's the third. Sabi ko kanina, security would be DILG, I guess. Medical will be DOH. The third will be DSWD, Social Welfare. And just to give you an idea, one step backwards, when the ECQ was declared, we did 112,000 food packs, the local government. They come in food vouchers that you claim in one of our 24 satellite city halls para may social distancing. Now we're doing 215,000 because the middle class is already affected. The lower middle, lalong-lalo na. When they were not hurting early on, they are now hurting because they've gone through their life savings. Sometimes may ginagamot pa sa pamilya. So if you ask me, Robbie, if my opinion on lifting, ako, I can tell you, if they ask me about Valenzuela, I can tell them, yes, we can lift it because I know all my positives are already in an isolation unit. All new cases are being tested. Now, if you ask me about Metro Manila, unfortunately, I'm not in a position to answer that because I don't know the situation in the other cities. I'd like to think we're all in the same page. So baka mas maganda-ganda na ilagay natin ngayon.
Yes, but whether or not you're on the same page, you're saying that one requirement that you will acknowledge is that you've identified every single positive case. That is a requirement that you would want to see across everyone before everybody can safely recommend and be on board with lifting the ECQ.
Robbie, no matter which literature you read, whether it's local or international, whether you're a layman or not, whether you're a doctor or a layman, it only tests one thing. Know your opponent through testing so that you get a clearer picture of whether or not, quote-unquote, which I don't like using kasi hindi naman a doctor, flattening the curve. You only get to do that if you know what you're up against. So ako, ang condition ko lagi, sana testing, isolating, binigay na ng national government testing, tracing, isolating. I think that's the formula. If they can tell us that they're doing it everywhere already or the LGUs are doing it, then by all means, I think we're ready to go. Pero if they can't answer that, then I'm a bit scared if we were ready to open up.
But Mayor, that brings me to my previous question kanina na how far are you go? How far would you want to push that testing?
Hanggang doon lang ako.
Kasi po, well, ganito po kasi, the DOH says that, yes, the protocols right now call for testing only those who have symptoms or those who are in the vulnerable sector.
Hindi na kami asymptomatic, we're testing, June.
Ah, even the symptomatic, kahit hindi sila, ano, hindi sa PUIPM.
Tinetest namin na backlog, tinetest namin, that's why nga we raised that holler a couple of days ago saying na pito sa mga asymptomatic namin nag-test positive and we had to bring them to the isolation unit. In the new decategorization of DOH, wala nang PUM. That's why I had to personally call Yusek Verhere and tell her, ma'am, I think you have to put it back because we're worried that these asymptomatic ones are the silent spreaders.
Oh, nga, sir. Because 81% of those who are infected do not show any symptoms or are only showing mild symptoms.
That's very true. That's why nga we kept on lobbying and even up to now, our aggressive approach in Valenzuela is all PUM, no matter if you're symptomatic or asymptomatic. Kasi pag PUM yan, asymptomatic yan, or else you become a PUI. So kami, we're testing them. We're testing them despite the fact that wala na sila dun sa category list.
Pero Mayor, I'm intrigued. No? Yung sinabi niyo kanina, sabi niyo you are actually ready to lift yung quarantine sa inyo. Anong ibig sabihin nun? I mean, we're into the fifth week.
Not now. Meaning, pagdating po ng April 30, at tatanungin ako kung anong status ng Valenzuela, I can tell you na kaya ko sabihin na sa Valenzuela contained namin yung problema dahil nga of testing. Kanina, I was telling nga our people, even our epidemiologists, they feel so empowered holding on to those kits because now we control the pace. Hindi tulad noon, pag may gusto kami i-test, nung unang panahon, tatawag kami sa national, papadalan kami ng kit, we ask for 8, they give 4. Then we give the 4 back, it takes days, 8 days, 9 days to get the result. So we were literally flying blind. And that goes with the partner nung tanong kanina, yung socio-economic. People are hungry, I know that. That's why in Valenzuela, we keep on feeding them. Our food packs ranges for a family of 4 to 5 that we can last probably 7 to 9 days. But how long can the LGU do this? We can do it for a couple more weeks, but sooner or later, something has to give. And the only way to stop this vicious cycle is if we test, we trace, and we isolate.
Mayor, your assessment of the social amelioration program. Kasi yung first month nabigay na, at least we'd like to hope na nabigay na nga yung first month. And then second month is coming next month. The last time we talked to you, sabi ninyo, yung population ninyo, 43% lamang ang in-approve ng DSWD na allotment. 48. Has that improved or ganun pa rin?
No. Ever since, I think you probably heard me wrong, ever since it was 48%. Pag sinama mo yung 4-piece, 53, which they paid in advance, so 53%. Sir Jun, you'll still be surprised that payout only starts tomorrow for some of our barangays because nga, like I kept on saying over and over, they're too tedious with what they want. I'll give an example. When they brought down the forms, we printed the forms for them. Mm-hmm. Lo and behold, they said there na kailangan everybody produces an ID, photocopy it, staple it to the form. Where do people, not a lot of people have IDs. Pangalawa, saan sila magsiserox? Pangatlo, saan sila magsistaple? So, anong nangyari tuloy sa Valenzuela, naglabasan sila, katok ng katok sa mga photocopier machine, nagkagulo yung mga kalsada namin. Then we devise a plan na para mabilis, Dropbox. We put Dropboxes across the entire city's satellite city halls, 24 stations, para hindi kami balik ng balik. Kasi what they initially wanted, pagbigay ng form house to us, babalikan namin yon. Ang point ko doon, what if mabagal mag-fill up yung pamilya? Di balik kami ng balik, sayang lang ng pagod and resources. So we told the people here, the minute you're finished, whether it's 30 minutes upon receiving the form, drop it off. Ang nangyari, DSWD came, the regional people, and started interviewing in front of the drop box. So again, nagkaroon ng build-up. Mm-hmm. So I raise a holler again about that. Kaya, in fact, I think I'm meeting Secretary Bautista tomorrow. I heard he's coming to Valenzuela to discuss nga these things. So talaga, you can see the lack of flexibility on the terrain right now. If we were not in a pandemic, great. Let's do all of these things. Let's put it one by one. But you want to feed people early on and you want to do it now. But it seems that their format is not inept with the terrain. Yeah, that's a problem.
Mm. Okay.
Sir, last question na lang now for me. If you're saying that you're actually ready for a lifting of the lockdown, are you...
Amin lang, ma'am. Sa amin lang.
Yes, sa inyo lang. Are you seeing a modified lockdown like the national government is now considering? Or are you ready for a total lifting?
Personally, I actually have... It's a very difficult decision. So, parang... To be honest with you, I just left a meeting with our city doctors and they were telling me off the cuff. If sila raw ang policymaker, they would still want to extend. But ako kasi I see the difficulty in doing the feeding of people around the clock. Eh. Medyo mahirap. So ma'am, ako, pag tinanong ako, sasabihin ko, ready ang Valenzuela because I have the data. I can actually point out to you ilan na lang ang nasa isolation unit. I can pinpoint and target. But then again, iniisip ko, pag modified, where they select areas, I was wondering, how do people... the cities of Metro Manila are interconnected. Eh. We may be 17 cities, but we don't survive by ourselves. Hmm. So, halimbawa, I would assume mga sa huling tala ko, parang 30% of our population actually from Valenzuela works in QC, Manila, Makati, Taguig. So, especially the younger ones.
Yeah.
So, paano sila pupunta doon? Yun ang tanong ko. So even if we lift it, yes, there's a semblance of normalcy for those working in the city, but there's still a big swath of the population that may still be affected. So parang akin, iniisip ko lagi, eh kung ganun rin pala, it might as well go all out na lang ulit and let's just get it over with by extending it.
Okay. Maraming salamat po, Valenzuela City Mayor Rex Gatchalian. Please stay right there. The Chiefs will be right back.
Maraming salamat.
Welcome back to the special edition of the CHIEFS here on One News. Katatapos lang po natin kay Mayor Gatchalian ng Valenzuela. And now we have with us another person who is very busy in this pandemic, Senator Richard Gordon, who also heads the Philippine Red Cross. Welcome to the CHIEFS, Senator. Senator Gordon, mukhang nawawala si Senator Gordon.
Parang na-drop yata natin si Senator. I think we're trying to reconnect.
Baka makinilockdown sa kanila.
Na-lockdown yata yung ating Red Cross chief. Pero magandang balita yung sinabi niya, no, ni Mayor Gatchalian na sila. At least yung mga constituents niya, masaya. At meron na silang ano, they're ready to leave.
There, Senator Gordon's online.
Okay. Senator Gordon, can you hear us?
Yes, dear.
Yes, okay. Yes, welcome to the CHIEFS. Problema po ang pag-uusapan natin. The Red Cross is very busy. Umpisahan muna natin yung trabaho niyo with the Red Cross because this week you came out with a story na magkakaroon tayo ng shortage ng blood. And kumusta naman yung response doon sa panawagan niyo for more blood donations? This is the Red Cross.
No, we're just anticipating a possible shortage because the blood supply has gone down to about 9,000 bags. So when it goes down to about 10,000, I start hustling for blood. And the response has been good. We were bleeding in Ateneo. We're going to go to Coast Guard. The military has also responded. So I think we'll be okay.
Well, hindi ba delikado yun, sir, na baka merong asymptomatic sa COVID na mag-donate? Hindi naman ako napapaning.
We always have a big interview. We always have a big interview when we're looking for blood. And, you know, you cannot be able to give blood if you have COVID, but after you're cured of COVID after 28 days, you'll be fine. You should be able to give blood.
But, sir, is there screening for blood? When it comes to COVID-19?
I don't think there's any screening for blood when COVID-18, but we do make a lot of interviews before we do the blood, and so we are able to get blood from our usual donors, and we have quite a bit of many donors in the Red Cross.
Senator Robbie Alampay po.
Hi, Robbie.
Kanina kausap namin si Valenzuela Mayor Rex Gatchalian, and Mayor Gatchalian was really emphasizing the need to understand the numbers, and he said, obviously, if you need the numbers, testing talaga kailangan. PRC, we know, is Spanish initiatives to help out on that front. What's the situation, or and not just for the PRC, but as far as you can understand at the top level of government, where are we when it comes to testing?
Well, we're kind of late, but I think we'll pick up very fast. PRC and the government is picking up fast. I don't speak for the government. I speak for PRC. We now have... tomorrow, hopefully, we will have another four sets of machines using the automated RNA system. And we should be able to test 1,000 per machine. So we already have four machines running. In fact, we did 1,000 of the leftovers by our RITM, and we were able to finish it. And now Batangas wants us to test their swabs. I just talked to Senator Recto. And tomorrow we will probably have the permit from RITM for our second lab. So we now have 8,000. And if we do it right, we can have a possibility of about 8,000 tests a day. But I will bet on about 5,000 tests a day because we're just starting. And the proficiency will get better and better. And when we do that, we can even go up to 12,000 tests a day because by Friday, we will have another laboratory with 4,000 tests a day capable. And therefore, I think we can bridge gaps.
Sir, you're talking about laboratory. So I suppose you're talking about the PCR or RT-PCR test kits.
That's correct.
Yeah. Sir, anong priority list nyo? Sino ang uunahin?
Ang unahin, kung walang tao, yung magpapatest, tetestingin namin, babahid lang naman sila. Then the, of course, we will prioritize those who are suspicious, who are suspected of having the symptoms, no? PUM, PUI, we will do that, no? But it works this way. The mayors will provide the testing, the swabbing, and they will also provide us with the digital personal circumstances, usually transported by computer to our computers here. And then we do the testing here, and as soon as we get it, we forward it to DOH, to the mayor, and to the person involved, and we keep a record in PRC. And we've been able to do that rather well so far. And the proof of the pudding will be in the eating when we have a tidal wave of people who are wanting to be tested.
Do you see yourself using the rapid test kits?
I'm not a rapid test fan. I don't want two tests. The PCR test is fast enough. It's capable of testing within 3 hours. In fact, this guy, Bong Garcia, general manager of MMDA, tested yesterday, and he was so happy he got his results this morning.
Clear. Sir, may napansin lang kami na. We've noticed kasi nag-pass ng resolution yung mga colleagues mo in the Senate calling for the resignation of Secretary Duque. And you've been quite critical of the administration on other matters in the past. So ngayon, ano yung ano? Bakit hindi pa kayo? Pipirma ba kayo doon kay Secretary
Duque?
Or anong tingin nyo? Why not?
Hindi ako pipirma dyan. Hindi ako magpa-participate sa political exercise at the time when we're all trying to rally our people to be positive. You can investigate later if there's anything to investigate. I think all of us are trying to work hard, and there will be mistakes. And you know, even America, the most powerful nation in the world, is having a difficult time. Italy is really suffering. Spain is suffering. China suffered. And I would say, I think we can do this. We have bigger fish to fry. I don't have to get involved in the intramurals of the moment.
So far naman, okay sa inyo yung responses natin. Considering na we all make mistakes, sinabi niyo na nga. So far naman, wala kayong nakikitang, parang sinasabi ni Secretary Duque, ito yung nagawa namin. So, generally, agree naman kayo sa ganong assessment ng situation.
I think if you change him now and change him with somebody else, he'll have a hard time, whoever he is. People are never satisfied in a crisis like this. And so, if he has to learn from scratch again, mahihirapan na naman yan. So ako, sinusuporta ako na lang. I don't see that, it's a big problem. It's about time that we have a center for disease control that will handle this. I think the DOH should handle public health in general, and a special warfare like this.
Kailangan i-separate centers for disease control. Yan ang sinasabi niya.
I think we lost the senator.
Hello.
Yeah. So I remember she kinikwento na niya yan noon na gusto daw niya ng centers for disease control na apart from the Department of Health. At ilagay daw under epidemiologist.
Senator, are you pushing for that?
Sir, Senator, na
I can hear you.
Will you be filing a bill along that line na magtayo na tayo ng centers for disease control?
I've already filed.
Yeah.
One of my recommendations after the vaccine was to file a bill on Center for Disease Control. And we prepared the bill. It should be ready to be discussed in the committee. And if they're not gonna move, we can always say we can bring it to the floor. If we have enough senators who say we can bring it to the floor right away.
So applied to COVID, anong mga salient points ng proposal ninyo yon? Applied to this situation.
COVID? Well,
kung meron tayo ng Centers for Disease Control, what could we have done in dealing with this pandemic?
If you look at other countries, they would have a prepared plan already. You know, for example, they would know how to isolate. Actually, the formula is basically the same. Kaya lang, mabagal lang talaga ang takbo dahil di pa na naiintindihan ng tao. So The thing is to identify what the disease is, isolate it by making sure that you do strenuous measures to make sure that it's isolated, implement a reasonable quarantine and distancing and washing of hands. It should be done all year round, in other words, so that people get used to it. And then finally, you help the people. So I think that kailangan dito ngayon, I think all that has been done. And the important thing now is to keep testing. Even in the United States, the American people are saying test first before you leave the lockdown. So you have to remember that we don't have the machinery right away. We started unang-una with manual testing. Ang tagal niyan. So we got automated testing. We learned our lesson.
Sabi ulit kayo, Senator.
We made sure that we got manual automated testing machines, and then we tried to do our best. We were ahead of the curve. We had face masks. We even gave some to people who were departing for China, for Macau and Hong Kong at the airport. We were able to give hospitals we gave PGH about 20,000 face masks and about 2,000 PPEs. We gave the same thing to major hospital here in Lung Center and NKTI. We have a tent at NKTI that handles dialysis. I think that if we work hard enough, we can pinpoint. You know, for example, I think that we have to make ready with even the American Red Cross now is looking at using arenas so that they can immediately have quarantine at the, in a fast clip. So I think we should be able to do that.
Okay. Senator, you've worn many hats, and right now you're wearing the hat of PRC. From a public health perspective, you've been a local executive as well. Dito po sa usapin ng pag-lift or not to lift or to extend the ECQ, where do you stand? At ano po ang matimbang sa inyo? Is it still the public health perspective, or at a certain point, does the socio-economic considerations start to outweigh the public health questions?
Obviously, hindi tayo pwede mag-perpetual lockdown. Pero, kung hindi pa tayo sigurado na kontrolado na natin yan, huwag muna tayo mag-lift ng lockdown. Perhaps, yung mga barangays that have no problems, I think they can be allowed to move around. They can make their money. I think you can pinpoint certain areas where our vendors can sell, provided they do distancing, provided that they are tested by the government at least once every 2 weeks or once every week. You can identify factories that stay overnight in their factories and start producing. But you cannot have a lockdown permanently, and you cannot have an immediate lifting of the lockdown because you're going to have problems. You have to do it right the first time. Kailangan tama ang ginagawa natin. Galingan na natin yan. And then let's start pasok natin yung unti-unti. Pasok na natin yung mga sinasabi natin dyan. Perhaps public transport should be done. Hindi na jeepney. Kailangan buses na talaga may mga lugar na mayroong mga spacing. I don't know if we have enough buses, but at least we can try. Or you can have staggered working hours so that people can go into their work in a matter na makakapasok sila na hindi masyadong dikit-dikit sila. So there are many things that can be done. We all have to put our heads together and we show the country na tayong lahat ay may ginagawa, tayong lahat ay may contribution. And when you do that, you have to inspire the people, you have to make them believe. And when you do that, I think we will have the problem licked.
Mm-hmm. But sir, do you think people are...
You think will hinge on the results of the testing?
Well, I'll tell you. Titingnan niyo yung test results, and I'll be very direct here. Makita mo ang San Lazaro had only 100, if I'm not mistaken, or 90 in a day. No, I'm trying to look at my sheet here. No, for example, RITM sometime about a week ago they were doing 900 tests as of that time. At that time, I counted it; they were doing 2,000 tests for the whole country. So that's how slow it was.
Yeah.
So, napakabagal, 2,000 sa isang buong bansa. Because, nagulat tayo, di tayo nakapaghanda ng tinatawag na test machine. Ngayon, ang haba-haba ng pila sa China, haba ng Singapore, para makabili itong testing machines. Alright? So, Mabuti na Red Cross, nakabili kami kaagad, and we have people out there who are helping us, and so nadala yan dito. I think, pray for us, if we do it well, we're going to be able to have a lot of testing done in the next week, and this is not the last. I have another plane coming on Thursday, loaded with machines for 20 more testing areas. 20 more.
Senator, if you don't mind, this begs the question, on, I think, on a lot of people's minds. We've been talking in the past days to local governments that have taken their own initiative to have their own testing. You're talking about how the Philippine Red Cross is able to augment and multiply the capacity of the government to test and to carry out thousands of tests. It goes back to a basic question from the very start. How come the national government couldn't bring that capacity from the very start?
Well, we're Monday morning quarterbacking, Robbie. I'm sorry, I agree with you most of the time. Walang magaling dyan eh. Kahit na siguro ako kung kahawa ko yan, meron pa rin manunulik sa. But as far as I'm concerned, we do it every step at a time. We learn from each other. Look at Mayor Gatchalian. He's able to do the 500 PUDs, PUIs, and PUMs. And then he's going to expand now. A lot of other mayors are now going to test in the Red Cross. Tomorrow they're all meeting here. I did not ask them, but they're all volunteering to be tested here in the Red Cross. And by the way, in Subic, where Walm is completed, Tarlac is going up. Batangas is going up. Los Baños, UP Los Baños is going up. I even talked with Ateneo. Ateneo is preparing to have their own machine, same as ours. And then we're going to go to Cebu. Cebu is being built for us. We have a big Red Cross facility there. Para mabilis, we have contractors who are willing to do that. And I think DPWH is willing to do it for us. Zamboanga, we're going to do that. In Olinto, they have a testing center, but it's manual. So we're adding another one there. This one, a big pass testing quad. So if we keep on doing this, it will start, and it's not going to be that big. We have to know, ano bang target natin of the population of the country, ilan bang estimate ng gobyerno na dapat tatamaan nitong gulo na ito. And if we know how to estimate that and put in more machines as we go along, and we can test, and we can speed up the people who are going to have to do follow quarantining. You can see some of the test machines that we have in the Red Cross. They're not easy to get, but we were able to get them. Where there's a will, there's a way. So, kailangan talaga, magtulong-tulong tayo. And by the way, this came from...
Nabitin ako doon. Parang nabitin ako sa sasabihin.
By the way,
chairman.
Okay, we have to go back.
Ano pa naman yung pinipicture? Maganda pa naman yung pinipicture. Na ako na.
But it's really interesting. I mean, I think to what Chairman Gordon said, it wasn't so much to Monday morning quarterback, but it wasn't even so much a question of why. But really, what I'm really curious about is the question of how. Anong nangyari na biglang bumulutok lahat ito? Okay, well, Chairman Gordon.
Senator, by the way. Nabitin kami kasi na-cut off ka sa by the way.
Okay. Marami nagdo-donate sa amin. Marami nagdo-donate.
Let me ask you to put on your hat now as senator. Are enough people getting enough help at the right time? I'm talking about the Social Amelioration Fund. May 100 billion na release na the other week pa from DBM to DSWD. But sabi nga ni Mayor Gatchalian, bukas pa sila mag-roll out ng pera. And that's only one city.
Speed is the name of the game. If you love your people, ang mayor dapat, walang politika dyan, pero alam ko marami na mong politika. Di pa ako kumikibo, pagkatapos na lang, huhulihin ko lang dyan. I'm really gathering enough evidence for them. Imagine they're even disregarding quarantining, no? Procedures or rather distancing procedures. Magpapapirma muna sila para dumami ang tao, para matuwa ang tao sa kanila. Then a few days later, magbibigay sila, pero nabibigay halimbawa ilan lang. Hindi naman lahat ganyan, pero dapat talaga mga account yan. Una, ilan ang binigyan sa CC sa 4Ps? Di ba? Mabibilang mo yan.
Ilan it was at 4 million last week.
Oh, sa mga
4 million vendors, 4Ps beneficiaries.
Oh, yan. Kung nabilang mo na yan, mache-check yan, even the Red Cross can help. Nabigyan na ba kayo? In fact, the Red Cross is also raising money from the international community. Nabibigyan namin yung hindi nabigyan. Ayoko magdo-double bigay. And yet, I keep getting reports from all over the country. Hindi kami nabigyan, wala kaming panggatas, wala kaming bigas, maawa na kayo. So, dapat ina-action na yan. We have an action center here that you dial 1158. When you dial that, it's not just to tell us that you have natatakot ka, baka may COVID ka, o baka kailangan ka lang dalhin sa hospital ng ambulansya. Pero sinasabi nila, pagka hindi sila nabibigyan, and many times, pag hindi sila nabigyan, tinatawagan namin yung mayor, tinatawagan namin yung barangay captain, nabibigyan sila. So there alone, makikita mo, hindi umaabot kaagad. So kailangan talaga, tinututukan yan. And everybody, gusto ko yung suggestion ni SP Soto na dapat i-broadcast lahat sa buong Pilipinas yung nabigyan ng pera at para malaman kung sino ang hindi nabigyan.
Senator?
Yes.
Pero Senator, kasi ganito, yung sa 4-piece, 4 million na nabigyan. Yung sa non-4-piece na 13.6 million benefit, as of Friday last week, nasa 300,000 pa lang. At nagtatalo, as of last week, nagtatalo pa yung DSWD tsaka yung LGUs doon sa ilan talaga ang dapat bigyan doon sa mga LGUs. Mukhang magkakaiba sila ng data.
Alam mo sa akin, nail it down, we'll fix it later. Kung di mo naman ninakaw, may papel ka ng binigyan, madadali ka kung nagluluko ka. Pero basta yung papel mo, may papel, may paper trail, mapapakita mo. Sa akin, mabuti na may nabigyan kaysa konti lang nabigyan o walang nabigyan. So sa akin, saka na tayo magtuos-tuos. Pagka nagbigay ka sa hindi dapat bigyan, dali ka. Dali ka. You can do that. I-report mo lang. Ito ang binigyan ko ngayon. Ito mga tao ito sa barangay na ito, sabi ng mayor. O pag hindi niya nabigyan, alapit sigurado kami hindi nabigyan. Middle class ka or upper class ka, ba't ka bibigyan? Ikaw, ang kinakawag lang natin, yung talagang the vulnerable. Yun dapat ang malalaman dyan. Dapat
Mayor, doon lang po tayo, Mayor, I'm just intrigued, doon lang po tayo sa lehite mo, I agree. Pag-usapan lang natin, kanina sabi nyo, pagka hindi nabibigyan, tinatawagan nyo yung, kung kailangan tawagan yung mayor, kung kailangan tawagan yung local government official, tatawagan, tapos yan maibibigay. I'm just curious, when you do that call, and it actually works, and it's released, what was the bottleneck? What do you find was, nasan yung bara? Bakit, ba't nagkaganon? Pwede naman palang sabihan lang, mangyayari.
Kaya na ayoko pag malapit ang eleksyon eh. Diba? Nagbibigay dahil, ito, malaking pamilya ito, bigyan muna natin ito. Ito, maliit ng pamilya ito. Tinitingnan nila. Systematic na yung mga maraming tao dyan ngayon na, tinitingnan lang kung sino ang bibigyan. Kung minsan kahit hindi dapat bigyan, malaking pamilya, bibigyan. Yung maliliit na tao, dapat makita. Kaya dapat may report palagi, may monitoring group, may DILG sa lahat ng probinsya. Dapat sisingilin sila, ilan ang na-monitor mo nabigyan at alin dyan ang dapat hindi nabigyan. So dapat pag ginawa mo, at least there's something working already, then you can call on other organizations to work with DILG there to find out whether in fact hindi nabibigyan yung mga tao.
Eh well, gaya nga po na sabi niyo, Senator, magdadating din naman yung araw ng pagtutuos at sinasabi niyo nga, now is not the time, unfortunately, now is the time to come together and do what we can. At kung may kailangang harapin at may pagtutuos, dadating yung araw na yon. But to that point...
Robby, hindi mo naman may tataro pag hindi mo nagbigay, may aangal eh.
Yes, but that's my question. Sir, are you confident on that point? Are you confident that at least the systems for transparency are in place to preserve everything that's happening, including the shenanigans?
The very fact that I'm suggesting a public accountability every day, ito nabigyan ng barangay Gordon Heights, ito nabigyan ng barangay Kabalan, ito nabigyan ng barangay Holy Spirit, ito nabigyan ganon, araw-araw, malalaman mo yan, at itignan mo lang yung, ako gusto kong hingiin yung listahan ng voters para makita ko kung sino nabibigyan talaga eh. Makikita mo kung sino nabigyan doon sa mga yan at malalaman mo kagad kung anong level ng kanilang katayuan sa lipunan. If you get the level, makikita mo yung malalaking pamilya dyan, mahirap lang, yamang anak, o may mga byuda, then bibigyan mo yan, vulnerable yan. Kaya dapat talaga, vulnerability at saka yun talaga hindi makapagana buhay, yan ang mabibigyan mo.
Senator, sinabi niyo na nga, hindi unlimited yung capability natin to assist people. And now, this week, people are talking about what happens after April 30? Magkakaroon ba tayo ng modified quarantine? Sa paningin nyo, are we ready for something like that? Are we ready to ease some of the restrictions? Saka ano yung pwedeng gawin natin? Sa pananaw nyo as a senator and as head of the Red Cross?
I think we are ready to fix it. Let's fix the problem. We keep fixing the blame. Ang dapat natin gawin, okay, itong barangay na ito, may premyo ka. Walang nagkakaroon ng sakit dyan. O sige, pwede ka na magbukas ng tindahan dyan. Pero binabantay mo yan. O, itong tindahan na ito, nagpa-practice sila ng talagang distancing. Makikita mo, may mga pintura doon sa kanilang lugar na puwipila doon sa mga mall na maayos. Pabayaan mo yan. Makakapagtrabaho yung mga yan. Tapos, every week, kailangan magpa-test yung mga tao nila. Or every 2 weeks, kung masyadong mahal, every 2 weeks magpa-test para malaman natin kung may tinatamaan na dyan. That may be expensive, but it's cheaper than having to give people money and throwing it away because you don't know kung binulis sa'yo o hindi.
So you think a modified quarantine is feasible by the end of the month? By the first week of May? Pwede na tayong dahan-dahan bukas?
I think there will be some modifications.
Kaya na natin.
There will be factories that will need to be opened. There are orders to be made, and it must not be based on sheer commercialism, but livelihood of the people affected. And therefore, kung mabubuksan mo yan with all the safeguards, kanya-kanya, the owners of the factories must be responsible for people. May nakasakit, sila tayaan, sila sagot. Bayagan ka magbukas, pero tayo mo yung tao mo. At pag ayaw kumalat dyan, sarap ka kagad. We can do that. Marami tayong pwedeng gawin.
Sa the Chiefs last week, sabi ni Joey Concepcion, mall daw, pwede na raw buksan. Do you agree?
I don't agree. I do not agree. Let's do this right the first time. Because if we do it right the first time, then hindi tayo magbabayad na mas malaki. The opposite is yung nangyari. Yeah.
But if there are safeguards, for example, if they maintain social distancing, they really make sure na lahat ng papasok, naka-mask, may temperature, the usual. We're going back to the first days. Do you think that's a doable thing?
I think it's doable. I think people are afraid. That's the biggest motivation. They're afraid and they're hungry. And business is losing money. And we're going to be having a hard time right away. So we can do it in limited on a limited basis with standards na based on performance of safety, based on making sure that we take care of our brother, and on the basis that ang presumption, lahat tayo positive. Kaya pagka ikaw nagkamali, pwede kang hulihin.
Now, Mayor, as you said, we're all in this for the first time and we're all learning through it. But I'm just curious, there are other countries, other cities that have started experimenting with opening up and so on. Meron ba kayo tinitingnan na models that you think are interesting either for the success or the failures or the limitations?
Well, look at Singapore. It's very disciplined. And yet, marami sila. When you consider the population of Singapore, which is, I think, about 6 to 8 million, ang dami nila may sakit.
Yeah.
So, pero sir, baka that's because you're testing so many people.
Well, that's possible. But tayo, just because we don't have it doesn't mean that we don't test. That doesn't mean that we don't have it. And that is why ako, I'm a firm believer in testing. Let us find the culprit in the body of Filipinos. And when we find it, heal it, remove that guy from the community. If he has relatives that have been compromised, take them along, test them right away, quarantine them, and then we will slowly beat this fight. We will win this fight.
Mayor, may mga bago pa
there's no quick fix.
Ang Red Cross ba may mga bagong project that you're looking at, considering what's happening
yes,
now? Ano-ano yung mga
we are
bago?
Considering, we don't go by projects, we go on need. We are considering opening up, and we have it here on the country, a hospital, an emergency hospital for those who don't have COVID. Maraming tao umiikot, hindi makapasok. Ayaw papasukin ang hospital. So ilalagay namin yung tent na yan, na air-conditioned naman yan, at may mga laboratorian at we are just preparing to get doctors there. And if the government will help us, we can open that tent if you like, and we're going to work with this. If the Canadians are willing, we'll work with them. And therefore, we people who don't have anywhere to go because they're being deprived, they can go there. So,
how much time do you need to get it ready, to get it up and running? How much time do you need? How much time will you need to get it up and running? Gaano katagal bago ma-operationalize?
I can do it tomorrow. In fact, I told my people last week they're already preparing it. Yeah. Pero tinitingnan ko muna kung saan ilalagay saan ang need. For example, you have the arena. Malayo sa hospital yan. Lagyan mo ng hospital doon na hindi COVID para yung mga kamag-anak doon na andun. Pag magpapatingin na andun, hindi COVID yon. Or you can put it near a major hospital para kung may kailangan, makakatulong yung mga doktor doon na mga dalubasa. And we can ask for, and we can request for additional hospitals like that if there is a need for it. And I think we can do that because the Philippine Red Cross is very much respected in the whole Red Cross world.
Senator, one more question. Your opinion of the resignation of Economic Planning Secretary Ernesto Pernia and the apparent reasons for his resignation. Sabi ng iba kasi, it was because of his position for a modified quarantine, which some say appears to go against the opinions of other members of the cabinet.
Yes.
You know, I'm sorry that we lost him. He's a good guy. He's a professor at UP. He has stated his position clearly in many times. And I think that's important to have people in the cabinet who will tell the emperor he has no clothes once in a while. Because it's important. And I'm sorry we lost him. But I hope the new guy, who is a young, a young fat hawk, if you like. I have disagreed with him many times. Of course, meron rin mga play sa palasyo, yung mga may mga kanya-kanyang grupo diyan eh na lalagay nila yung ka-teamwork nila at para sa ganoon eh magkakaroon. And hopefully it works. If they don't work, then they will be found out and they will be held to pay.
That's all I can. May kwento si Secretary Pernia kanina na meron daw mga bubulong-bulong kay Pangulo na hindi team player yung si Secretary Pernia.
Hindi team player.
Hindi daw. Mga secretaries daw na mas malapit kay presidente kaysa sa kanya, binubulungan daw, whisper into the ear of the president that Pernia is not a team player.
Well, that is always the path of the people who have agendas, no? And at the same time, ako ang sinasabi ko palagi, I've learned in the long experience in government that you better embrace your critic because he will tell you the truth. Sometimes your friends will not tell you the truth. So listen, and you have to have good judgment and don't rely on the we belong crowd because that's dangerous.
So keep your enemies closer.
That's right.
Well,
so I think Pernia is a good man. I think, but they think his leaving makes their team stronger, will be better for the country. I pray for that. But if it doesn't, like I said, they will have to answer for that resignation. It's hard to get good people
that's
here.
That's a question, no? Whether it represents a schism, as it were, in the cabinet. That might not go well for us in terms of the decision on whether or not to lift the lockdown.
And I'm laughing because you know how to lay a trap for fools like me. No, I'm going to bite on that. There's always a schism in any cabinet. There's always a bunch of, even in the Senate, may mga kanya-kanyang grupo, may macho group, may seatmates. And you know, we have to learn kasi to work with each other. That is the difficulty of this country. There are so many parties when you should only have two political parties and one should not be shifting. Pag nanalo ka, doon ka sa administrasyon. Hindi dahil ikaw yung bumoto sa Senate President. Sa administrasyon ng partido mo. Pag natalo ka, nasa opposition ka. So you always have the other side, a shadow cabinet if you will. But I think it can be done, but you know, it's all up to us as Filipinos to be mature. We are a great country. I have no doubt about the skills and talent of our people, but kailangan somebody's got to harness the talents and skills and energies of our people.
Okay. Red Cross Chairman and Senator Richard Goton, maraming salamat po for joining us tonight.
Always a pleasure. Lucci, Ami looking good. I don't know about the two guys beside you.
Sir, thank si Ami ang katabi ninyo eh. Hindi kami. Maraming salamat po, Senator Gordon.
Sige pa. Salamat po.
Thank you.
Okay, up next when we come back. Yes, sir. Well, up next when we come back, we will be talking about mental health naman. Maraming salamat po, Senator Gordon. And, Senator, the Chiefs will be right back. And welcome back to the Chiefs here in One News. We are on the final stage of our conversation for this episode. And with us to talk about the mental health aspects of measures against COVID-19 is Dr. Amado Alinea of the Philippine Psychiatric Association. Doctor, thank you for joining us and good evening.
Thank you for the invitation, Ed.
Mm-hmm. Doc, there's this perception, I don't know if you agree with it, but there's this perception that Filipinos don't seem to put as much emphasis as they should and importance as they should on mental health. Now with the COVID-19 and the lockdown, we're going to our second month already, and you can imagine the stresses that people have to go through being locked in their homes, sometimes without work or without employment. How will this play out for Filipinos' mental health in the next few months?
Well, as of this time, I think it is becoming more obvious that a lot of people are suffering from some mental health issues, from the frontliners to the people in the community. The fear and anxiety of this crisis is actually overbearing during these trying times.
This is the first time. Doc, I don't know if it's possible to do this on a national level, pero lahat ng tao, I think we're all experiencing the same thing. Lahat ng tao nagtatanungan, when will this be lifted? Ililift na ba ang ECQ? Ililift na ba ang ECQ? If there's such a way or such a thing as taking the temperature or diagnosing the whole nation, what would you say is our psyche right now? What are we all collectively going through right now?
What we're saying is that, quote-unquote, it is normal reaction to an abnormal situation. So it is okay to be okay. This is something that we experience. It doesn't mean that if you experience this, you are in the verge of a mental collapse. Almost everybody from the frontliners, the anxiety level is very high, but the fear and the anxiety actually for this crisis actually is very overt. It is there. It is something that is not actually seen. So we know where the fear and anxiety is coming from. So that is where we would like to tackle this issue.
Who would you consider to be the most vulnerable?
Well, frontliners are very vulnerable, particularly those who are in direct contact with individuals, primarily because of the possibility of contamination. The war with this crisis or with this COVID-19 is actually an invisible war. So that is the even with some protective gears, a slight deviation might result to also being contaminated.
Okay, so frontliners and then
so there are actually two aspects. Yeah.
Close, mm. talk?
So there are two there are two aspects to this. It is both the medical and the socioeconomic. So the our lower income individuals also suffer from the stress of this quarantine.
Ang doko man naman doko kasi yung bang mga halimbawa sabihin na lang natin yung mga may kaya are they less vulnerable than say the ones in the fringes? Know how the mental state of people on a socioeconomic level does it differ depending on class or whatever?
I think this the mental health, the effect being affected with this mental health issue goes to all stages of strata. Even the upper strata of the society, as you have seen, they will be the first individuals to go on panic buying. They are so scared of going out. While if you see the lower income people, they are out in the streets. They seem to be not so fearful that they might be contaminated. So all levels of socioeconomic, I think everybody is affected here.
Dr. Alinea, there's also concern that if you are stressed, it will lower your immune system. Is that a very big problem in this case? As madali tayo mahahawa kung tayo is stressed out.
That is already an evidence-based findings. Even before, individuals suffering from cardiac problems or pulmonary problems, once you are stressed, usually your system reacts to it also. Immune system also falls down when you are in severe stress. So that will really affect when we are in contact with our patients.
So importante napaka-importante ng mental health. If we want to be free of this virus, anong pwede natin gawin by way of improving our mental health while we are still under quarantine? 2 weeks pa to, anong pwede natin gawin?
As of this time, as I've said, we would like to tell everybody that it is okay not to feel okay. This is a reaction, as I've said, to the current crisis. There are several ways where we can try to help individuals. One is by trying to minimize on our daily watching or viewing of news. Overexposure to all this news actually being very, very stressful. Especially for people in the media who are covering every day.
Pwedeng i-distress namin. Pwede pa yun. Pwede pa yun sa watching the news. Ano pa pwedeng gawin to distress?
Huwag naman yun, sir.
And improvement.
Huwag naman yun, gano'n.
I think what we should do is we have to change our perspective as to how we interpret the news. Instead of probably looking at the number of deaths and number of positives, we should try to also look in the number of people who are improving or being discharged. This is how we always look at the bad side of the news, but it's also good to see that there are people recovering. There are news that tells us that there are a lot of new testing centers which will help us individuals. And now, I guess this would be the first time that any one of us has probably spent as much time with our family as ever before. And we could just go on with our individual activities at home. For children, maybe we can also minimize the social media and just try to see what are the things that they have to do in school when they're in school. For the elderly, we can always send messages or, as I've said, thanks to social media, we are able to talk to them and see them in virtual reality, in virtual time. So these are the things that we can do.
Sir, sabi po ni Jeannie Goldborn, who runs the Hope Line Foundation, there has been a 200% rise in calls from suicidals. Is this something that you would tend to understand? in a time like this?
Well, as I've said, this is the trying times when individuals will really be suffering from a lot of emotional disturbance, sadness, anger, frustration, anxiety. But we in the association, we opened our site for what we call the Mind Matters, and several of these institutions who are helping out for free to be able to do some psychosocial processing for individuals who needs it. We are also, a lot of also our doctors are doing telemedicine because, you know, we still have patients who are there who needs to be seen, who needs to have their medications taken. So this is one way of being able to reach out to them in the technology that we have right now. I think it's very helpful.
Yeah, Doc, we've been talking about the situation right now and what people can do right now. But obviously something like this is traumatic on very many levels for all of us. Is this going to be, is the mental health question arising from COVID going to be a long-term issue?
You know, the ball game is played by resiliency. And you know that resiliency is time-bound. So for the time being, for a short period, a lot of people may be able to handle this. But in long-term, then that would be a question. There has to be a balance between medicine and economics here. So long-term, then we have to look into. And maybe we should ask our government as to what they plan to do about this.
Sir, nakakatulong ba yung naglalagay sila ng mga coffin sa mga barangay para matakot yung mga residente?
You
think about it, but do you think that's an effective way of keeping people?
The culture in the Philippines is quite diverse, but basically what to be properly educated. That is why we have to have messages that are simple and easily digestible by individuals. That's why doing all these things like putting this coffin or harsh punishments, maybe that is only good for, you know, for some individuals. But generally, I don't think that would be a best way of managing and telling people about social distancing. Even social distancing, we actually would wish that this would just be a form of physical distancing rather than social distancing, because what we're doing now is something that is social, and you don't distance each other. We actually get more closer through internet.
Yes. Okay. Sabi pa nila yung ano raw yung alcohol manufacturers are now lobbying na dapat daw i-lift na yung liquor ban. Do you think that the drinking, you know, tendency of Filipinos is something that will be helped, or it's going to be detrimental to them anyway?
You know, drinking is a social activity.
Exactly.
And more often than not, people will congregate in one place. In some cases, they share the same glass. Mm. They share the same plate. They share the same spoon. Nobody gets to wash their hands. You know, I think this would. Yes, ma'am.
Doctor, what about physical exercise? Does it help improve mental health? Does it help ease depression?
There have been so many studies. Physical exercise do a lot for our mental health. Do it on a slow phase. You can do yoga. You can do Pilates. You can do other forms of physical exercise. And this is
Zumba.
You do all these things already have been proven to be a positive way of improving your mental health.
What about watching Korean novelas?
Binge watching.
like the kingdom, puro zombies yung ano yung pinakalabas.
Puro zombies yung ano.
Well, that is something to entertain you. It's something. This is something to entertain everybody. But as we recommend, we also try to minimize, you know, to try to have some particular number of hours when we engage in internet and Netflix or other video games, and to do other physical activities at home. I think this is the best time to, especially for our children, to teach them some of the responsibilities in the household. And hopefully that they will also have a regular sleeping pattern. More often than not, I've been hearing so many news that children sleep late and wake up late. Yeah. And they only get their breakfast is like 12, and they only eat the full meal at dinner time.
Right.
That's because of this technology that we have.
Yeah. Yes.
Nakausap pala ni Doc yung anak ko.
Bakit?
tanghali ang almusal eh.
That's not healthy, because eventually they will have to go back to mainstream of whether school work, and we do not want for them to be able to have difficulty in adjusting when they go back.
A serious question, Doc. Samantalahin ko na. I mean, what does it do to the body? I mean, physically, physiologically, if you disrupt your sleeping patterns and you take an extreme, nagpuyat ka at nasanay ka sa kakapuyat, never mind yung adjusting for school later on. But what does it do for you? And going still to our topic of mental health, is it unhealthy as well?
You know, sleep is a vegetative symptom of our body. It is a very essential function. It is it is something that restores our energy. So if we are overdrained, like, you know, any batteries, eventually there will be difficulty in whatever activities you will have, either would be mental, whether it be physical, or even social interactions. So sleep is a very vital function of the system. It cannot be disregarded.
Sir, di ba?
Is there such a thing na sobra? Is there such a thing as nasosobrahan ng tulog?
Well, oversleeping sometimes may be a symptom. It can be a symptom of insomnia. It may be a symptom of depression. You know, it's either hypersomnia or too much sleeping, or insomnia, which is inability to sleep.
Yeah.
It can be a symptom of an incoming mental health problem. If you have noticed, most of our patients who come for consultations, usually one of the biggest problems they have is problem with sleeping.
Yes.
And because this is also, more often than not, this is a prodrome to an incoming problem or mental health issue.
Yes, yes. So what is a healthy sleeping schedule?
There is no such thing as qualitative sleep. This is more of quantitative. I mean, this is not quantitative. It is qualitative. It should be a restful sleep. It doesn't matter if you only sleep for 6 hours. It doesn't matter. If you see that there are circadian changes when you grow older, I'm not saying that you people are getting older, but but you see, it is the quality of sleep that we are talking about. It's something that, despite the duration, you feel restored. You feel good when you wake up in the morning. Because some people who are depressed, even though they slept for about 12 hours, notice that when they wake up, they still feel tired.
That's true. Mm. Yes. Okay. Maraming salamat po sa inyo, Sir. Dr. Alinea, and sana nga, we'll be talking to you in better times.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you very much for this invitation. Yes, and as I've said, our association, the Philippine Psychiatric Association, has an open line, which is the Mind Matters. You can see that in the internet. And we're giving free consultations right now.
All right. Thank you, po.
Thank you very much.
Salamat po.
Good evening. And thank you very much.
That'll be all for this special edition of the Chiefs. And we hope that what was discussed here will keep the conversation going. I'm Luchi Cruz Valdes of News 5.
I'm Ami Pamintuan of the Philippine Star.
I'm Ed Lingao of TV5.
I'm Robbie Alampay, and we are One News.